Hi kids, how's it going? Welcome to our second virtual music lesson. Never thought I'd say that. Some of you may have missed my first lesson. I posted that on my Google Classroom, which you all should have gotten the invitation to, and you should all be here, and that's great. So watch the first one if you get a chance to, because there's some important updates on there, and we also learned a little bit about Mozart, which was pretty cool. So now let's go on to our second lesson. You may remember that in February we celebrate excuse me, we celebrated Black History Month, and we talked about famous African American musicians in our history. And then in March we celebrated Women's History Month by talking about famous female musicians. You might remember we talked about Evelyn Glennie, the Scottish musician. She was a percussionist, and remember she was deaf, right? She said things like, when she took her shoes off, she said it helps her to hear the music because of the vibrations. And then we did that fun percussion activity where we tried to feel the music in our feet. So now we're in the month of April. And in April, we celebrate Jazz History Month. So this month, we're going to talk about jazz music a lot, and I think you're going to really enjoy it. I love jazz music. To me, jazz music is so exciting, and it's different, and it's the best. So I think you're going to enjoy it. So I want to start off our discussion on Jazz History Month by talking about this guy. His name is George Gershwin. He was born in 1898, and he lived until 1937. He was born in Brooklyn, New York, so he's a New Yorker just like us. He taught himself to play the piano at a friend's house by following how the keys moved on a player piano. I'm going to post a video in the same comment where I'm posting this video. I'm going to post another video of a player piano. So you'll see what that is. I'll explain it to you in this video, but then it'll help you to watch the other video. It's very interesting. So they used to have these player pianos where you would insert, or you would put in music inside the piano, and it was like a machine on the inside of it, and the keys on the piano would move by themselves, and it would play whatever piece, whatever song you put into the player piano. Sounds kind of crazy. Watch the video. It's really, really cool. And actually, the song that they're playing in that video is a song that I know for a fact my kindergartners have heard before. Not sure about the other two grades. Possibly. I think so. Check it out. So when the Gershwin family, when George was a young man, a young boy, when the Gershwin family finally got their own piano, George surprised everyone by sitting down and playing the songs he had learned by himself. The thing was, his parents bought the piano, but the piano wasn't for George. It was for his brother. But it turned out that the brother wasn't as interested in the piano as George was. So George wound up taking over the piano. George liked to compose both classical and popular music, and found a unique way to combine the two. He composed his most famous work, Rhapsody in Blue, in 1924. The same year, he also had a hit show on Broadway. Wow. Gershwin also wrote the opera Porgy and Bess. He is considered one of the greatest American composers. So cool. So that's a little bit of background on George. I'm going to play for you a show on a website that's called Classics for Kids. It's a website that's designed to help kids just like you to learn about classical music, jazz music, all of that. So this is just audio. So take a listen. I might pause it on occasion, just to break things down and explain things just a little bit. So this is George Gershwin.
I'm Naomi Lewin. Welcome to Classics for Kids. More than anyone else, American composer George Gershwin found great ways to combine classical music and jazz. Gershwin was born in Brooklyn in 1898. He was the second of four children of Morris and Rose Gershowitz, who both came to New York from Russia. George's older brother, Ira, was a straight-A student, but George was definitely not. People used to say, "Mrs. Gershwin has nice children, but she's going to have trouble with that George." When George was 12, the family bought a piano for Ira, but George amazed everyone by sitting down at the keyboard and playing. Turns out that he'd been sneaking over to a friend's house and teaching himself by imitating the way the keys moved on their player piano. A player piano works sort of like a music box. It has a moving roll of paper with holes punched in that make the piano keys go up and down and play. George Gershwin went on to become a very good pianist. George Gershwin loved composing both classical and popular music. The year he became famous for his first classical composition, Rhapsody in Blue, he also had a hit show running on Broadway. The person who wrote the best lyrics, or words, for the songs George composed was his big brother, Ira.
You say either, I say either. You say neither, I say neither. Either, either, neither, neither. Let's call the whole thing off. You like potato, and I like patata. You like tomato, and I like tomato. Potato, patata, tomato, tomato. Oh, let's call the whole thing off.
Ira was just as great at writing lyrics as George was at writing tunes. For most of the 1920s, George and Ira Gershwin wrote two or three musical comedies a year.
I got rhythm, I got music, I got my man, could ask for anything more. I got daisies in green pastures, I got my man, could ask for anything more.
When George Gershwin found just the right hit song in one of his musicals, he turned it into a concert piece. Ira wasn't the only family member who got dragged into the act when George wrote music. One year, the Gershwins visited Paris, and that trip started George thinking about a composition. He knew just what he wanted to use in his piece, so he sent the whole Gershwin family out to search all over the city for just the right French car horns to put into An American in Paris. When Gershwin met Russian composer Igor Stravinsky, he asked if he could study with him. Stravinsky said, "Tell me how much money you made this year." By then, Gershwin was a very successful Broadway composer, so when Stravinsky heard the answer, he said, "In that case, I should study with you." On a visit to New York, French composer Maurice Ravel said there were two things he absolutely had to do: meet George Gershwin and see one of his shows. Gershwin asked Ravel if he could study with him, but Ravel said no. He was afraid Gershwin might wind up writing second-rate Ravel instead of first-rate Gershwin.
I'm going to pause it right there for just a second. So what you're hearing, guys, is just a couple of sections of the works that he of this of the pieces that Gershwin has written. And that last thing that they were just talking about, so there's two other people that they mentioned. One is Igor Stravinsky, and the other was Maurice Ravel. Those are two composers. Remember what a composer is? Someone who writes music. Composers write music. But they're very important musicians that I studied when I was in college, in my music history classes. And they heard Gershwin's music, and Gershwin wanted to take lessons from those two composers on how to be a better composer. And both of them said no, because they thought that they weren't going to help him to be a better musician. They thought that they could only make things worse, which is pretty interesting for two composers who were pretty famous at the time in the world of classical music. So they didn't want to influence him in a way that would change who he was. So Gershwin was really, in his music, he was expressing who he really was. And it wasn't affected by anybody else, which is pretty interesting. So, and I think my favorite part of that video was the beginning when the teachers were saying that his brother Ira was a great student and that George was going to give his parents problems. Well, I think they turned out to be wrong. So, very, very interesting stuff. There's only about a minute left in this video, so in the show. So I'm going to play the rest of it for you and keep showing this picture of George Gershwin instead of seeing my face pre or before coffee. So here you go. I'm going to make sure it's in view. There you go.
Part of Gershwin's genius was the way he combined different musical cultures, from Jewish to jazz, to come up with his special sound. When Gershwin found a book about African Americans in Charleston, South Carolina, that he wanted to turn into an opera, he really did his homework. He spent lots of time in South Carolina studying how people talked, lived, and sang. Gershwin wrote his opera Porgy and Bess in 1935, and it's still the best-known, best-loved opera by an American composer. But the most famous piece of classical music by George Gershwin is the first one he wrote,
I'll go back to that in just a second. So Porgy and Bess is an opera. You heard that opera singer singing just now, right? Interesting fun fact. You know who Mr. Elliot is? Mr. Elliot is the band teacher. Well, he actually has a neighbor who was in this opera in Porgy and Bess at the Metropolitan Opera House. That is like the coolest thing ever. Ever, ever, ever. The Metropolitan Opera House is one of the most famous opera houses in the world. So the fact that Mr. Elliot knows someone who performs in the most famous opera house in the world, doing one of the most famous operas in American history, is so, so cool. And it makes me so, so jealous because, as many of you may know, I am an opera lover, and I used to sing opera when I was studying music in college. My voice teacher was a famous opera singer. So, yeah, I'm an opera nerd and I'm proud of it. So, this is almost done. I think it's got like 20 seconds left.
The first one he wrote, Rhapsody in Blue. Next week, all about rhapsodies. I'm Naomi Lewin. I write classics for kids and produce it with Tim Lanter at WGUC Cincinnati. Please join me next time for Rhapsodic Music on Classics for Kids.
Okay, so I'm going to post the link to this website so that if you guys want to see the show and if you want to see other shows and learn about other musicians and other composers, you can certainly do that. I'm going to finish things off by playing one of the pieces that's talked about here. And it's actually my favorite piece by Gershwin, and it's called Rhapsody in Blue. And as you're listening to this, I would like for you to pick out the instruments that you can hear. And I want you to maybe see which one is your favorite. Let's see here. Okay. So let's pause there actually for just a second. What instrument was the first one that you heard? If you guessed clarinet, then you would be correct. The first instrument you heard was the clarinet. And it's not often that you hear clarinets sliding between notes like that. Right? Whatever that note was. But yeah, isn't that, that's like, it's the coolest thing. You usually hear trombonists doing that. But anyways, let's keep going. That next instrument was a trumpet. That's if you guess that, then you are correct. And that trumpet has something called a mute in his trumpet to make it sound kind of funky like that. It kind of looks like a plunger. That next instrument, piano, of course. pause it there because the piece is actually a lot longer than that, and I don't want to, drag this out longer. I'll post a link to that video as well of Rhapsody in Blue, and you can pick out all the instruments and the big orchestra. That'll be very, very cool to do. All right. So that's that, guys. That's our show for today. Our second virtual music lesson in the books. Okay. All right. So I will see you guys next time. Stay safe, stay well, keep washing those hands, and see you soon. Bye.